Hi, Nicholas. Thank you so much for being here.
Hi, Azam. How are you?
Good, thank you. It's very fascinating what actually project you're working on. I don't want to explain what it is. We just want to hear it from you. So tell us what you've been working on, and then we go ahead with that.
Sure. Well, I've been working on a variety of things for a very long time that are all within one major theme. And that major theme is, I suppose, finance and how people relate to finance and how behaviors relate to people and markets. And the project that I'm most excited about, although I'm very excited about Bitcoin and things like that, is a project called Verus, and it's at verus.io, and it's about privacy and truth for all, and it deals with many of the big societal issues that we're facing as it relates to our privacy and our civil liberties, and it's about how you build a system innovating on the insights of Satoshi Nakamoto, the pseudonymous founder of Bitcoin. And it looks to try and solve some of the challenges that we have in the decentralized distributed world of the blockchain. And as part of that, I'm also an entrepreneur that founded a company called Valu, or some people say it Valu. And that's located at www.value.earth, and on that website there's a sort of a range of projects that I'm involved in. One is called Arkeytyp, and that relates to hardware that we call the Kiko system, which is about understanding how humans need something totemic as a token, and oftentimes to understand the new paradigm, or as Marshall McLuhan says, the medium is the message. And Verus, the public open source protocol, which enables privacy and truth for all using a UTXO blockchain. And it creates self-sovereign identities that are issued, recoverable and revocable autonomously, which is a huge leap forward in the known art. And it also includes DeFi, which is decentralized finance, but, you know, real decentralized finance that solves the problems of front running, which is a problem with the Ethereum system. And finally, it's fully fractal, which means that everybody, you know, who mints an ID can in fact create their own token or their own public blockchain, so that you have a totally scalable environment. So, you know, our mission has been, you know, very long in the IP space. We started in 2007, which is obviously pre-Satoshi. And then, you know, today we are at mainnet with the blockchain, and the community has some 5,000 members. It's grown completely organically. We have 20,000 nodes or so. You can't really tell how many you have exactly, but, you know, someone in the community did a count of some description. And it's about building towards a decentralized distributed future that empowers people.
So I have a question. Why privacy matters when we live in a very public environment with all these, like, you know, cameras and satellites and everything is watching us? Why does it matter? Why does it?
Well, privacy matters because whilst you might trust a regime now, if that regime were to change and there was, you know, to be an all-seeing eye of the state and they decided that you were the enemy, then you would have no civil liberties and you'd have no agency in that world. And that's obviously the world that some people have been through. There are regimes excuse me, around the world, like in China, or well, in many places, or in Russia, or in parts of the Middle East, where you do not have civil liberties that are granted to you by a constitution or a framework of law, and you know that restricts your ability to be who you are. And so, you know, America has, you know, an imperfect political system, and you know its constitution has some weaknesses, but in terms of the farthest forward in the development of a political system that, you know, can scale, because obviously you can have different political systems at different scales. But in a situation where you have a large group of people, you know, it's much more difficult to put that together. So, you know, the main reason why you want privacy is in case your side doesn't win the election or doesn't get to be in charge, that you still have your rights protected and that you could not be persecuted.
That's exactly what I was looking for. And also with this, that all these like massive chaos that is actually happening in the world, and obviously there's no privacy, how can we get it back with, like, for example, like even like this platform that I'm talking to you, I don't have any privacy. Everybody, well, somebody might actually get into this conversation or to this Zoom call, or it might be recorded. How hard is it to get all these together? And like, what are the challenges that, for example, you as a leader in this field that you?
Well, the challenges are many, because, well, we would have to go back to the beginning of how economics, you know, if you look at back to Adam Smith, I think he published The Wealth of Nations in, I think, 1776, interestingly enough, something like that. And, you know, he evidenced this idea of the invisible hand, which people perceive as the market. But he was also referring to the invisible hand as the way that corporations and economic actors control politics, because, of course, they make up a large organizing feature of the marketplace, because they were employers, and therefore they, you know, created a different, well, the economics of the time created a different world. And the potential for corporations to be the invisible hand was something that Smith, as a moral philosopher of sorts, also understood. So he warned us, and he, you know, showed us that the economics was the new force. And indeed, we get to a point in society whereby corporations are massively powerful. And that goes through different phases. And we're in the phase where the technocracy is the invisible hand that guides all of our perceptions, right? And our perceptions control our behaviors. And there's a, you know, lovely work by a guy called Donald Hoffman around humans as conscious agents. And as conscious agents, we are now in a world where our time is effectively sold in, you know, in the pursuit of economic interests. And that's, you know, keeps everybody busy and working hard. And it also traps people in what we call the trauma loop, where working paycheck to paycheck puts an inordinate amount of stress on the average human. And, you know, also when they feel that they don't have a huge amount of agency and opportunity, it, you know, it threatens our, you know, societies at large. And so as we move into late stage capitalism, where you have a small group of companies, well, you know, at the moment, I think it's something like 6 or 7 companies account for 50% of the value of the S&P 500. And you understand that those people have much more knowledge about you than you do. You have something called information asymmetry. Well, you would expect your government to have information asymmetry, but, you know, you wouldn't really expect corporations to have that level of information asymmetry. And Shoshana Zuboff wrote very eloquently about it in her book about surveillance capitalism. So we have surveillance states and we have surveillance capitalists, and those surveillance capitalists have effectively funded the internet through, you know, the attention economy. And so your time gazing at your phone, otherwise referred to as the black mirror, and this sort of indulgence in the twin self has been the feature of the, you know, the last 30 years, I would say, as we've moved to this, we've been digitized, but we didn't digitize our human rights. We allowed for our human rights to be effectively severed from us in the internet world. And our human rights seem to only apply in the physical space. And so what I think we are seeing through the blockchain, because of its permissionless and trustless, unstoppable feature, is that we are able to pose a question because of Satoshi's innovation, his resolution of the double spend problem, i.e. the ability to have a ledger of truth that is kept by many counterparties rather than a truth that is kept by a centralized ledger, or centralized counterparty. We have this interesting thought form. And for those of us that were interested in this thought form, you know, it probably went, you know, for me, it went back probably to 2003. You know, Satoshi eloquently stated this, and this is the reality we are at now. And it had to acquire energy, and energy in the modern era is money. So as Bitcoin accelerates in value, the believability of a trustless, permissionless, unstoppable network owned by, for, and of the people becomes a reality. And the first movers who understand the mathematics see it first, and then come the traders, which is where we are now. We're in the trading moment of the market. It's full of, you know, interesting people who are extremely creative, who came from the old banking world, you know, much to everybody's chagrin. I'm sure, you know, I used to always tell people that they were going to be, you know, these neo-bankers, and, you know, they were believing that they were changing the system, but they were really morphing into techno-bankers. And this is where we've moved. You know, the technocracy has infringed on our society, and we've seen an exploit, a couple of exploits in the experience of the Cambridge Analytica, which was obviously, you know, not doing anything that they were not permitted to do by Facebook. So Facebook exploits as regards the Brexit and as regards the election in 2016, we saw how, you know, people's perceptions could be altered, and therefore you could change societies. Well, that's sort of like a stock market exploit, really, because you can go long and short that. And then we saw essentially this move to being in this post-truth world where you can't tell truth from fiction, because who is certifying the truth? And therefore we went through the alternative facts expedition. And, you know, my viewpoint was that we would be post-trust in 2020, 2021. That was sort of my general thesis. And, the second part of the technocracy and the way that information becomes valuable was, of course, in the economics. And we've seen the ascendancy of the technology and technocracy in our economic life, and what that enables. And that was basically based on a freemium model where you are the product. So the human was productized in this period. That's how we were able to deliver the internet, or the technocracy was able to deliver the internet. Mm-hmm. And that was funded by a group of financiers who were venture capitalists, who essentially, and private equity participants, who essentially moved money away from the public markets and into the private markets. And those private markets were funded, you know, by very large pension funds and endowments, who I used to advise at JP Morgan. And I started to understand there was, you know, so many of these asymmetries. So there was a financial asymmetry. And then the VCs obviously went and found interesting businesses and then funded them such that no one could compete. So you could be effectively non-profitable. So we moved out of the Adam Smith phase where it says, you know, there should be profitable businesses. And we moved into a phase where capital bought network effects. And that's the model we've been operating in. And these technologists and their funders have used capital asymmetry to create massive advantages in their businesses, because you cannot compete without large amounts of capital to subsidize a business in order to capture the networks. Well, again, those networks are migrating, and that's the innovation of Satoshi. Can be thanked for that. That's what creates that opportunity. And then the final field that came about was healthcare. And of course, healthcare, if you think of life as a three-legged stool, you have your financial field, your social field, and then you have your wellness or your health field. That if you have those three legs on your stool of life, you will be sitting comfortably. If any one of those is a little bit short, you're going to be unbalanced or uncomfortable. So the wellness field is the final field of the data. And that's obviously protected by various different regulations around HIPAA compliance and various other things. But the pandemic obviously accelerated the need for the technocracy's skills in providing tracking and tracing and all of these other things that could have averted a disaster. But yet again, the trust in both the government and the technocracy is such that we weren't able to use that technology for our benefit. And so all of these things we thought when we started back in the day, yeah, well, the public blockchain that is Verus.io started back in May of 2018. I was interested in identity from 2007. And before. So from our perspective, the issue was that you have to be able to issue a self-sovereign identity. That is to say, it can't be from the UN, it can't be from a country or a company, it has to be from you, just like you emanate your identity from you. You're not taking your identity and saying, you're not saying, Microsoft is going to give me my identity and I'm going to walk out around as Microsoft Azam, right? Rather than, you know, Apple Azam, right? That doesn't, you know, you don't do that in the human world. But in the digital world, you don't have any human rights, essentially. You sign them off when you accept the end user license agreement or the EULA. You sign away all of your powers in return for this good or service online. And that basically is, you know, ridiculous. If someone asked you and said, oh, you can come to this fun fair, but you just have to sign, you know, this theme park, you have to sign all your rights away, however, that if you, you know, that we can do whatever we like when you come into this fun fair, you know, you would say, there's no way I'm going to do that. But exactly. When you come into the fun fair of Clubhouse, or you come into the fun fair of Google, or the fun fair of Apple, they own you. Now they say, yes, but we have this privacy and we have this, you know, all of this stuff. It's not true, because you don't have the ability to take that data and monetize it for yourself. They own your identity, essentially. Now, yes, you have certain privacies. In Europe, you have the GDPR. In California, we have the CCPA. And these are relatively new innovations. But the fact of the matter is that the future will enable a self-sovereign identity system, will enable you to assert your own self-sovereignty and to take attestations. It's not to say, the government is not going to require you to have a driving license or have a passport. No, you should be able to give them that information, but you should have the right to have an attestation from DMV at or the passport office at that essentially says, I've now provided this information and I can use this information as countersigned or notarized by a duly attested authority. And that gives you the ability to then accumulate experiences in your digital life that it would enable you to have sovereign digital identity rights, that you are the consolidating factor, and that others may be able to hold repositories of data about you as they are duly required to, like KYC or AML, but that you are the authority on you. And imagine a world where you can use that in a way that is provided by zero knowledge proofs, which are basically a mathematical way to verify and verifiably prove any data to be true, and that it can also be completely private. And so what we have to look at is that the identity that is you in the digital world should have the right to be completely private, just like you do. You don't have to tell me anything on this call. I don't have to tell you anything, right? I'm choosing to disclose information to you, and you know we're engaging with each other. But in the digital world, there are people crawling all over your information right now, and whilst they may not know it's you, they are monetizing it.
So you touch base on really great issues, such as how big tech is playing as a role in terms of invading all those privacies and censorship, obviously, and the government. And as a matter of fact, now with the COVID, it has also created another layer of governments to enforce those kind of like their privileges to people in terms of like lockdowns and limitations and the curfews. So what at Valu you actually offer, and if you can walk us through a kind of like a case scenario that how a future would look like in your terms.
Sure. Okay, so let's start from the top down. So the protocol level, where you have the blockchain itself, which is a new proof of power, which is 50% proof of work and 50% proof of stake, with a delegated proof of work back to the Bitcoin blockchain. So this is Verus, verus.io, and that's the security that you require on a blockchain. Then you have an ID that is created that is a Verus ID essentially. And that is unique, and it is something that you are able to issue, to revoke, and recover, whereby you can do that autonomously. That means you can do it yourself, right? That's an important thing. You need to be able to do those things. And then what you want to be able to do is not to have to rely on going to an exchange. You want to be able to exchange peer-to-peer, right? That was the aim of Satoshi's original vision, right? To exchange peer-to-peer. And that peer-to-peer exchange should happen in a fair way. That doesn't mean that you get taken advantage of, that you don't get arbitraged. So you want to create a decentralized finance marketplace where you have automated market makers and that there is no front running. That would be, you know, a dream scenario. You know, people would say that's a utopia. But in fact, the amazing developers of Verus.io and the community that has come together to do this has enabled us to do this. And then you have this thing called public blockchains as a service, or PBAS. And public blockchains as a service enables you to effectively, when you mint that name, it's, some people could say it's like an NFT. An NFT is a non-fungible token. Well, what they're referring to, it's a bit of a strange name. It's a bit of a misnomer, right? It's that in reality, the non-fungible token piece is the name itself, right? That is the one of one. That's the unique thing. So what you're able to do when you have a unique ID is to create a token, which you can make as a reserve or a public blockchain, which you could mine and stake. So this is the hybrid nature of the blockchain, means that you can mine and stake it, which is something that enables you to build an economy and to build security. And so what you have with every public blockchains, or creating public blockchains as a service, it means that you can take your name, so you can be Azam At, and that is your ID, and it's your wallet. And that also has full privacy using Z addresses. And it also has transparent addresses, so that you can share things completely transparently, or you can shield your information to keep it fully private using cryptography. And I'm trying to be able to talk across so many levels of sophistication, but in the conception of Verus, which is a very, it's really an advanced technology. It's taking all the learnings from the UTXO blockchain, the Satoshi's innovation, and adding to it, additional sophistication. So you have ability to use this unique ID that you've created that can create mm-hmm. a token or a public blockchain, and that it can enable you to issue and sign anything of value. You now, like you react to the world, you in your own mind process that information, right? You relate to it. Now, this is very different to the existing internet system. And I can see that it's like, people always have trouble understanding this. And this is what used to be referred to as the flippening, right? There needs to come a time where the game inverts. And the inversion of the game is to understand this it's a very nuanced thing. And it's where people say, oh, your data is valuable. Well, your data actually on your own is not very valuable. And I think some people put a sort of value on it about 30 cents, right? It's the data is abundant. What's interesting is what you can learn when you aggregate network effects. And so, exactly. Mm-hmm. on your own, you're not worth very much. But when Facebook puts, 2 billion people together, suddenly this becomes, the group data, the group fitness becomes mm-hmm. extremely interesting. And you've now got these large aggregators, Chinese government, WeChat, Alipay on, the centralized, the super centralized side, right? And then you've got the technocracy on the Western side, which is notionally, supposed to be resistant, censorship resistant to the government. But we've seen how there's an interplay between the government and the technocracy, right? So we can see, and the population at large sees now, there is an invisible hand. The market's one of the invisible hands. Then you've got the invisible hand of the technocracy, and the technocracy seems to be moving towards money, and it's moving towards wellness, and it's moving to all these fields of valuable data. And I'm being told that my data is not valuable to me on my own. But what Satoshi shows us is that if you create decentralization and you bind people together and you enable them to verify, not trust, by using a ledger that is public, that's the public blockchain, then you can suddenly show, you can effectively enable people to understand, the story of the bundle of sticks. One stick on its own, you can snap. You put 13, a bundle of sticks, you put 13 sticks together, you can't break it. That's what Satoshi is showing. And he shows it in 2009 in the white paper. And over, 12 years, people start to believe in it because people believe in money, because money's become the way that people rank people in our society. The more money he's got, you got to listen to him. He's a billionaire. The fact that he got lucky, and we mistake luck for skill all the time, is irrelevant. Now, some people really are very talented for a reason. There are massively talented people that understand something better than other people, and they do well. Now, in the old world that we were in, those very smart people get rewarded for understanding these things and exploiting these things. And you move towards this game where you have what people refer to in markets as the Cantillon effect, which is where the rich get richer because they have much more leverage. And when you have interest rates going to zero, those who can access these low rates have more and more leverage in the game. And so you get polarizations. And so we're seeing a polarization in politics. We are seeing a polarization in economics. And all of this is about understanding that the middle is being stressed, right? And so, again, ideas of democracy, ideas of decentralization are based on trying to get the middle to understand. The extremes already understand. The extremes of the right, saw how the president was deplatformed, and they reacted to it viscerally. And they said, we're going to make our own system, and it's going to be Parler. And they went to try and list Parler on the Play Store and on the Apple Store. And the technocracy said, I don't think so, because we think that you're inciting hatred and we don't want to be there. And they said, okay, well, we'll go to the internet. And then they realized that Amazon AWS was going to have to host them. And Twilio both said, no, thank you. They violate our terms of service. And, you know, a whole group of people were deplatformed. Whether you agree with them or not, Voltaire is the, you know, the measure here, which is to say, I may not agree with what you say, but I will defend to your death the right to say it. And so what we see is that those rights don't exist, that there's a different, you know, whether it's right or wrong, there is a very clear revelation there of this hand, right? And right. People see it, right? So let's think of these invisible hands now. The technocracy is showing its invisible hand, and so is finance. And then comes the GameStop example is a good situation, where again, it's a movement of power that is based on the bundle of sticks. It's not really about decentralization for them. It's about showing the power of the people, and whether for good or for bad, or to play silly games and win silly prizes, it doesn't really matter. It illustrates, because the communication is so fast, that these things can be done. And when people can see that these things can be done, they will do them more. And so the world of crypto, the world of cryptography, is the world where the most innovative people in the world are spending their time, you know, at the forefront of trying to solve these problems. Some people are solving for making money, and some people are solving for societal problems. And the ones that are solving for societal problems were the ones I was sort of looking for. And so when I found Mike Totonghi, who's the lead developer at Verus, and I read his white papers and we started talking, I knew that I had found someone who had a very, very unique and deep understanding of, you know, these issues, alongside my comprehension of these issues, and had a technical skill level that was beyond anyone I'd seen in the blockchain space. So I had been to see a number of the protocol founders, and I had been in dialogues with a number of the protocol founders very early on. And it was clear to me that no one had really come to a resolution that would enable the flippening to happen, because they hadn't put self-sovereign identity at the primitive level. And right. That is something that is going to be understood in the future, and very few people can understand it right now. But as these, you know, as we were observing these things back from 2007, but, you know, really with some aggression in terms of understanding what was happening from 2014, which was when it sort of accelerated, it was very, very clear that we were going to be in a different type of world in 2021. It was absolutely certain that people were going to realize the value of their financial field. They were going to realize the value of their wellness field, and they were going to understand that their social data, you know, people, you know, the technocracy knew them better than they would. And when you get to that position, people will feel that it's time for something that is owned by, of and for the people. And Satoshi was able to create a proof that now has, you know, common knowledge. And not everybody has it, but people have some knowledge that there is this thing that's not controlled by anybody that has $1 trillion worth of trust in it, or energy in it. And that's a big idea.
I mean, that's fascinating. You mentioned now 2021 is obviously is the moment that everybody's realizing and coming to that awareness and conscientious that privacy is important, decentralization is important. And now that we are at this forefront of technology, I mean, obviously there's a huge gap between the regulation, and I mean, you explained it really well, and how these big tech companies are taking advantage of like all their power and obviously all their platforms and everything and their products, right? That people have become their products, not their products are providing any solution to the people. So how far?
I don't know, actually, I would contest that, because I do think that the technocracy provide great services to the people, right? They really do. And Gmail's amazing. You know, the Google is fantastic. The issue is that you are the product, and that, you know, is, you know, as Google refers to it, is there's the creepy line, right? You don't want to go over the creepy line, but now everyone knows that they're well over the creepy line, all of them. And so it's not that the services aren't great and that it's great to have these free services. It's that we could probably have these services and pay for them and have our privacy too, and that we could have their market cap. So what about if we could have Google's market cap go to the community who can synthesize all these products now? Because, you know, anyone can replicate software, right? And so, you know, that's the thesis of Andreessen Horowitz, A16Z, which is software eats the world. So if software eats the world, then why can't we just have the people's Uber and the people's Airbnb and the people's all of these things? Because software is just software. That's not hard to do. And what you realize is what's hard to do is to get the customers. And that's when you need to get the VCs who will spend, you know, 40 cents, lose 40 cents in every dollar capturing the taxi market, right? And destroying the yellow taxi business. And that business should be destroyed. I don't know. I don't have an opinion about that. But it seems to me that, you know, people buying market share and then jacking against the drivers and then planning to replace them with autonomous cars seems to be like not necessarily the best thing. But if that was owned by the people, then, you know, well, maybe it is a good thing.
I totally agree. But my point was that, for example, the product that Google or Amazon is providing is actually being consumed by people, right? But then without the people and without the users, they would not be existing in the first place. And the reason that they are existing is because I'm providing also a lot than what they are providing in return. So regardless, I mean, plus I'm actually using their services and I'm paying for that. They're also collecting a massive amount of data that are also contributing to their marketing. And also they sell that data to the different parties. So it's just like different layers of players involved. But from the consumer side, it's only the consumer. They're only, you know, getting from one-sided.
Right. So if you imagine, so that's exactly right. So if you imagine that you are now the center of value, that's the illusion in the name, is that value is about you being in the center of value. And
exactly.
Is about understanding that everything that you do that you can digitally attest to and attach to your identity is of value to you and is of value to society. And it's a value to financial providers, and it's a value to healthcare providers, and it's a value to the world. But you on your own are worth relatively little, but when you're combined with your fellow humans, you're worth a fortune. And that if we can understand that what makes us similar is far greater, just like in our DNA, we're 99% similar, you know, we will find that in our hopes and aspirations, we are 99% similar. And that's because the world, you know, operates in this idea of mirror consciousness or reciprocity, where morality emerges as a natural phenomenon. People say, oh, well, you know, morality is something that comes through religion or this. It really doesn't. It comes through the idea of do unto others as you would have done unto you, right? And these are the ancient ideas which, you know, are called mirror reciprocity or have given these fancy names, but it's really the golden rule, which is, you know, just you want from others what you want for yourself, right? And then you have the reductive rules, which Nassim Taleb, I think, refers to as the via negativa, or the silver rule of Hillel, which is that don't do unto others what you wouldn't want to have done unto you. And so that's sort of the lesser rule, right? So there's a positive rule and a negative rule. And that sort of was what comes through and informs civilization, right? Is that you have freedom from and freedom to. And This is the, you know, the way that you get this divergence between the French philosophers and the American philosophers that start these ideas. And so we are seeing, you know, the net outcome of these different ideas born out in Europe and born out in America. And in America, you know, life is nasty, brutish, and short, and is competitive and is based on money. And the economy and the politics that move around that have a very specific signature. And this is, you know, where we've reached today. We are at that inflection point, as registered in money, as registered in technology, and now registered in health. And it's culminated with this pandemic, which has accelerated us at least 5 or 10 years in the digitization and the digital future, because people have also had this, you know, what happens in wars and these large, you know, global scale events where everyone experiences the same thing at the same time, you get these leaps in consciousness. And the leap in consciousness that we've gone through is in everything that we've understood. And we've also been locked at home. And that's given us a lot of time to reflect on ourselves. And you very rarely get such a time, as, you know, for all the stress and all of the anxiety and the, you know, the inequality that has come through the pandemic. It's also enabled people to look at themselves, because they've been locked up with themselves. And that's normally a feature of, you know, retirement, when people get to reflect and say, oh, you know, I wish I'd have done this or that. So everyone's getting this pause. And, you know, you can imagine it's like, you know, God has come from the heaven, and you imagine like a Monty Python sketch and put his finger on the world. And when you put the finger on the world, when the world's spinning at 1,000 miles an hour at the equator, you get a lot of things get, you know, carry on moving at 1,000 miles an hour and hit walls. And we've seen lots of our, you know, presuppositions flying through as the world has been stopped and hitting walls of comprehension. And that's, you know, our approach to the office, our approach to social, you know, socializing, our appreciation for family, our appreciation for our mental health, our appreciation for communications. And so we've been given this very powerful jolt. And, you know, that's going to be the, you know, when we look back, that's going to be the big thing, that people are going to say, wow, you know, look at what that did to our society. And the question is, are we going to carry on doing what we did before? Or are we going to come to consciousness and say, we want self-sovereign identity, we want our sovereign digital identity rights, we want human rights that enable us to earn a basic income based upon our contribution to the collective? And by the way, we don't need anybody's permission to do this. We can just use the innovation of Satoshi and others, of course, because everything is built on, you know, the shoulders of others, and have a technology that enables us to unify across nations and across boundaries, and be able to verify and then trust to create massive collaboration, massive cooperation that unleashes, you know, the potential of the Internet of Value. And so the Internet of Value, which is the empowered self-sovereign individual plus value exchanges, right, at low friction, is really the, you know, the enabling architecture that is as big, in my opinion, as the Gutenberg printing press, because it enables the internet to be truly free again.
That was well said. So how far are we from reaching that utopia? I mean, now that we are in 2021.
It's not a utopia. It's not a utopia, it's exactly a reality. If you go to verus.io, you can, you know, verify and then trust. You can read some excellent Medium articles that sort of extrapolate what was being built and is being built. But, you know, the blockchain itself, this proof of power, enables the, you know, the security and the economy of the blockchains themselves, and this idea of public blockchains as a service. So that's been running since 2018. So that's, you know, great. And then the identities are also on mainnet. So you can go and buy an identity now for, you know, the lowest price is probably 20 Veris if you, and it's a whole referral system so that all the people in the system get the benefit. If you use the foundation's ID, you can get your price down to 20 Veris, but 100 Veris is the basic price. And that gives you the beginnings of having this amazing ID. And that this ID, you also can set up a revocation and a recovery ID so that you never have the problem of losing your private key. You never have the problem of losing your funds. And you can lock this in a 21-year trust or a vault so that, you know, if God forbid something happens to you, you know, one of the big issues for crypto is if you lose your keys, you lose your money. You know, you've seen, everyone's seen that story with that guy. Well, you know, we had to resolve that. That was a user experience and that was not acceptable. That was a barrier to going mainstream, and someone had to come up with a way to do that. And you know, having these very, very powerful IDs that are revocable and recoverable allows you to ensure that you never can lose your funds and you can never lose your private key, because you can always revoke and recover the ID and respawn your seed. And that's something that had to be done. And you know, the UI, the interface needs to be very, very intuitive and very simple. And that's, you know, where we're at the moment is coming towards the UX and UI phase, where, you know, integrating this. So you've got the protocol layer, and then you've got applications that we've built above. And that's where, you know, my private interests were, you know, started, was what was really at the level above, as well as understanding what you needed at the protocol level to be open source and to be, you know, fair mind and have no ICO and no founder rewards. It had to be done in such a way that was very counterintuitive to the traditional system. And so, but still retain enough incentives to get people to do, become a community. And that's really the challenge of building a public blockchain, is building the community to support it that wants, you know, has such a deep desire to build a technology that has integrity. It's really, really difficult. And so, I think that's really something that, you know, everybody should try to do. But now the technology is built, the last things we are taking to testnet now is the decentralized finance with the automated market makers that enables you to create pools, and you could have a buy coin that would be, you know, two assets, Bitcoin and ETH, or you can have a tri coin or a quad coin. In fact, you can have, you know, many, many currencies. I think that someone in testnet has got like 25 different currencies in a pool. So you can do all of the pool cool things with pools that people do on DeFi. And furthermore, because it's at the primitive level, it enables you to solve the problems of serial processing. Now, this used to happen in the old finance world as well, where you would have people who wanted to be closer to the exchange to get faster processing so their trades would go ahead, because you've got high frequency traders. Remember, the crypto market is a high frequency trader market. People talk about it at the retail place, but this is really an HFT market. And that's filled with people like CTAs and trend followers, which is, of course, you know, where my history was as well. So, because this is just...
it's a 24/7 market now.
It's a 24/7 market, and it's run by computers and bots and algorithms. And, you know, people who are looking at volatility in a very different way. They're not looking at it, like I said before, in single stock terms. They're looking at it in aggregates of flows, because the market is getting bigger, and it's like, you know, there are waves on the top and then there are currents underneath, right? So people trade the waves, some people trade the currents, you know, everything is different, you know, in different time periods. That's what people don't really understand. You know, every trade you have two, you know, completely opposite opinions. And I always ask people, what do you think the difference is? You know, there's someone selling, someone's buying. you have Janus, right? You have the two faces facing opposite directions. And now people say, oh, you know, I think it's this, I think it's that. And very rarely do they realize that what separates a trader is just time. So it's really the wave particle observer effect, right? It is physics in a way that you've got one person who owned it in the past and had a history of ownership. And the person who's buying it has a view of the future that is completely diametrically opposed, or maybe just not coinciding in a time space. So it's about understanding that, you know, all of this, I mean, finance and technology is about time and space. This is where physics and finance meets, is through the mathematics of the blockchain, right? That's what's going on. This is what we call consilience. This is the bigger thought process that's going on behind all of this, which is the unity of knowledge is coming from this giant amount of data. And that's why you don't want the unity of knowledge to be owned by a corporation or a government, because then you will lose your agency and you will no longer be Homo sapiens, you will be Homo proteus, that is an augmented human, that you don't know that your perceptions are being manipulated. And that's what's going on with a lot of people. We all have people that we think are being manipulated by information that is in fact a misperception that is creating a misbehavior. But who is to say what is a misperception? So
and
this is where you get
predictability, right? I mean, imagine
that's about probability
and predictability.
And predictability, but predictability comes through probabilities, right? And that's what you get, is if you understand the probabilities, you can nudge people using behavioral economics in, like you can with markets. If you understand the trend and you understand the flow and you have enough power, you can nudge.
And you can control.
Right. And if we look at our elections, they're very small margins. When you see, you know, great tennis players and you look at the total points won in the match, the difference between the winner and the loser is really very different in points. But at the critical moments, the great players have much more power to force the points. And that's the real game, right? It's understanding that this is the game of life. And there are players who are playing it who have far more agency than you, and that you need to ally with your fellow man. And you need to realize that we are 99% similar in what we want, but we are being divided by those who, you know, seek to divide and conquer, because that's a great way to play the game.